Very good. Thank you. Thank you, praise and worship team, setting the atmosphere. Good evening, everybody. Good evening, good evening. Welcome to the house of our God. Welcome to this great house that is upon the earth. It is the house of our God. Amen. Well, we're glad you're all here tonight on a Wednesday. I do want to look around the room and just say hello to a couple of folks. Helen, it's good to have you out on a Wednesday night. We'll start with you. Sure, we'll give her a hand. Why not? Glad you're here. Marissa, it's good to see you back again. We're glad you're here, Marissa. Let's give Marissa a hand, too. And George, my father's talked about you, and it's good to have you out tonight. Thank you for coming, sir. We know you have lots of other commitments, but the fact that you took time to visit us tonight, that's really great. All right. Thanks, George. And we go around the room. Harry and Nettie, of course, I'm glad you make the efforts to come out, Harry. I know you fight through certain things, but the fact that you come here is awesome, you know. And Peg, that's enough out of you, okay? We missed you for two services. Enough is enough. No, we love you. We're glad you're back. Yeah. And hopefully most of you had a chance to meet our brother Edward. Brother Edward, we're glad you're here. Welcome in the name of the Lord. Amen. Glad you're here. I don't know how long you'll be in this neck of the woods, but while you are, we invite you to find a church home here, all right? And hopefully it's not the last time that we see you. We're glad you're here, brother. So, welcome, everyone. Welcome. We are in our series tonight, as you see on the overhead. The series is Our Good Father. I believe that we have a good father. Does anybody else believe the same? Amen. Excellent. And if you look at the handouts that were given to you at the door, hopefully you all have them. The title is Pentecost, and I did mention last week that I'd like to talk about Pentecost for a couple of weeks, maybe 2 or 3 weeks, explore it some. And you can see the subtitle there is Pentecost, a Release from Heaven, a Release from Heaven. So before we start our main text this evening, which is found in the book of Acts, of course, let us look together at the definition of Pentecost. First of all, Pentecost does mean 50th. Pentecost commemorated the giving of the law on Sinai, the 50th day after the Exodus. Interesting. This feast of Pentecost was kept in remembrance of the giving of the law upon Mount Sinai, whence the incorporation of the Jewish church was to be dated, to be just 1,447 years before this. So after Moses gave the law on Mount Sinai, that was the first Pentecost. It was 50 days after the Exodus. What Exodus? The original Exodus with Moses, right? 50 days later on Mount Sinai is when they received the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue. And then in commemoration of that, 1,447 years later was the time when Jesus ascended on high and he told his disciples, don't do anything until you receive power from on high. And we'll read that in a moment in Acts chapter 2, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, right? The day of Pentecost was fully come. We'll pick that up in just a moment. But look, if you will, at the rest of the definition here, because I like it. It says, fitly, therefore, is the Holy Ghost given at the feast in fire and in tongues for the proclamation of the law of the Spirit. We now have a new law. It is not the law of Moses, but is the law of the Spirit. Not as that to one nation, because remember the law, the Ten Commandments, was only given to the Jewish nation, by the way. But now this new law, the law of the Spirit, I love it. It's given to every creature. Every creature. How beautiful is that? And then it goes on and it says, this feast of Pentecost happened on the first day of the week. The first day of the week is Sunday, by the way. It happened on the first day of the week, which was an additional honor put on that day, the day which the Lord has made. What is the day which the Lord has made? Well, it's the first day of the week, which is now our Sunday, to be a standard memorial in his church of those two great blessings, the resurrection of Christ and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, both on that day of the week. The day of the Lord. The day of the Lord. He made a day after himself. It was the day that he rose from the dead, and then it was commemorated again 7 Sundays later, the Feast of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was sent. Beautiful, huh? The day of the Lord. What is the day of the Lord? It's the day when he arrives, the day he shows up, the day he reveals himself to you. So, if you will, I would like to read the account in the Bible in regard to the day of Pentecost, the coming of the Holy Spirit. It's found in the second chapter of Acts. You all have your handouts. And I'm going to ask Pastor Dad if he'll start the reading for us.
When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a mighty rushing wind and filled the whole house where they all were sitting.
Then there appeared to them divided tongues as a fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance.
Okay, very good. Go on.
And they were dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven.
When the sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused because everyone had heard them speak in his own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, "Look, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each in our own language, in which we were born? We hear them speaking in our own tongues, the wonderful works of God."
Excellent. Okay, let us go on.
But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words, for these are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel, and it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your young men shall see visions, your old men shall see dreams.
And on my men servants and on my maid servants I'll pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name
Very good. Good reading, everybody. Let us pause there and talk about this account right here. I'm just curious, by a show of hands, how many have read this passage or are familiar with this passage here, Acts chapter 2? Okay, most of us. This passage here is in reference to the first Pentecost that the church experienced. As a matter of fact, it is the birth of the church, if you will, where God sent forth the Holy Spirit to birth the church and to empower the church. And we can see all of the wonderful things that transpired on that day. Number one, I think the greatest thing that we see here on the day of Pentecost is this was a very spiritual happening. There was nothing natural about this. When God birthed his church upon the earth or revealed his church upon the earth, something supernatural happened. And all of the elements that we talked about the mighty rushing wind that came suddenly. We talked about the fire that appeared in the room. We talked about, I think perhaps the most supernatural of them all, they all began to speak in other tongues. Is anyone familiar with that happening, speaking in tongues? Some of you might have experienced the baptism of the Holy Spirit where you're able to speak in tongues. Either way, I want us to see that at the birth of the church, even the speaking in tongues, some of us are familiar with it, even if we don't participate in it, it shows the absolute supernatural impact of God upon this earth through his church. That's what tongues show. If nothing else, it tells you, it is not of this world.
Amen.
Amen to that. It is not of this world. And if that were the only thing it told us, it's good enough.
Amen.
It's good enough. And I pray, even as we talk about this and revisit Pentecost, I pray that every time we enter into the house, it's a symbol, of course, but every time we enter into this house, may we know that this is no natural house.
Amen.
And it is a spiritual house.
Amen.
And spiritual things happen. Invisible things happen. God things happen. You know, sometimes they happen when you want them to, and sometimes they happen when you don't want them to.
Amen.
You know, sometimes you got some spooky things going on in church and you don't really like it. Have you ever had something in church happen that you don't like? Sure, any given Sunday. No. Only when we're visiting other churches. Sure, absolutely. There's things that happen in church that are not natural, not normal, not rational, that some we like and some things we don't like. You're going to get a real honest amen to that one. Sure, absolutely. But, when you need God, when you need something supernatural and it happens, aren't you grateful that it happens? That's right. Because there is a place and there is a house when you need the supernatural. When you don't care about what anybody thinks or what it looks like, all you need knows you need God. Amen. You need something that is beyond this world and beyond this earth. You need to know that there's something greater going on than all these physical things, right? That's right. And it's there for you. And you see it at the beginning of the church, the day of Pentecost. God wants to show you there's nothing natural about his house. It's absolutely supernatural. It's filled with the power and the glory of God. Amen. There is something unnatural about you, and it's spiritual. Yeah, that's what this tongue shows. And yeah, you know, speaking in tongues, it's a gift from God, and it's something that if we experience, it's a good thing. If you want to experience, you can experience it. It lets you know that there is something supernatural about you. Sometimes it helps you connect with God in a greater way at times. You know, I do like the words that Paul spake. He said, when I'm with you guys, he said, I speak in tongues more than all you guys. But when I'm with you, there's no sense me speaking to you in tongues if you don't understand what I'm saying. I'm going to speak to you words of English so you know what I'm saying. But there is the power of speaking in a foreign language. But it's not necessarily greater than your English language. It's not necessarily greater. The only thing that's greater about it is that all you can do is speak about the wonderful things of God. Right. You see, sometimes with our natural language, we speak about more than the wonderful things of our God. Can I get a witness? Can I get another witness? Yeah, sure. See, that's the nice thing about tongues. It's impossible to speak anything lousy. If you're speaking in tongues, I know you're not hurting anybody. But you see, it should also get us to a place where, you know, the real tongue of heaven, I don't care what language it is, the real tongue of heaven is a proclamation of the wonderful things of God. Amen. Whether it be spiritual, English, Spanish, German, it don't matter. And those things teach us. But I want us to see primarily that this speaking in tongues, it's proof of a supernatural existence that we live, right? Yeah, indeed. Absolutely. So, you know, you see, moving right along, you know, this is where Peter rises up. And Peter, this is the first sermon preached in the first church ever. You ever wonder what the first sermon was in the first church? This is it right here. Peter. Peter rose up on the day of Pentecost and he says, what does he say? He says in verse 19, he says, well, he starts off in verse 15, which is really beautiful. You know, for these things, these are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. And he goes on in verse 16, and he says, but this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. Don't you love these words? I love them. And it shall come to pass that in those days, in the last days, says God, in the last days. When are the last days? According to Paul, they were 2,000 years ago. So I don't know why we keep thinking the last days are in front of us. They're not. They're behind us. The last days is when you come to an end of yourself and you enter into the day of the Lord, right? Yeah. The last days are the last of your days. It's the last of you living a natural life and you entering into a spiritual life. Yeah. You leaving your day and entering into his day. The last days that Peter is talking about is not some end cosmic event. The end days is when you come to an end of yourself, you enter into something called Pentecost, and you start to live a spiritual life. You start to live in his day. That's what Peter's talking about. Because Peter said, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. He says, these words are now fulfilled within your ears. So, I mean, this is the first lesson ever taught in the first church. And the first lesson, the first sermon ever given in the first church ever was, these are the last days. We missed it all. I thought we just started. But we did just start.
That's
what Peter was saying. It was the end of an old covenant. It was the end of an old way of thinking. The last days, they're over. He says the old system is over. A new day has dawned. Those are the last days. I don't know what we got our heads stuck into, right? But Peter preached this the first Sunday ever. Okay, great. So he says, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And he talks about them prophesying, your young men and your old men. And he says, I will show you wonders in heaven and signs in the earth below. And it says blood and fire and vapor and smoke. This is what happened in the day of Pentecost. It's not in your future. It's in your past. Peter said, this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. He was describing what was happening in his day. Was there a physical blood? Yeah, there was a physical blood. The blood of Jesus, man. It spilled from the cross not 50 days earlier. I don't know what this blood in the future we're looking for. Peter said, it's filled with the blood of Jesus, everybody. The blood of Jesus. It spilled on the cross of Calvary, and they were going to start to begin to preach the power of the blood of Jesus. Not the physical blood, but blood is symbolic of life. They were going to start to talk about the life of God, the life of Jesus that is now available to everybody. That's the blood it's talking about. I don't know what we're thinking. And it talks about fire and vapor of smoke. Peter was describing what was in the room that day, not what's in your future. This happened 2,000 years ago. There was fire in the room that day. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
It says there was cloven tongues of fire on all their heads, man. The fire was in the room. What about the vapor of smoke? You ever see the glory cloud? I'm sure the glory cloud was there also. Remember when Moses was given the law on Mount Sinai? What covered the mountain? The smoke, the cloud. It was there. Peter said, this is that. Here we are. Oh, great. Okay. Okay, good. And it said, the sun shall be turned to darkness. Well, it kind of did, right? When Jesus hung upon the cross, didn't the sun turn to darkness? This ain't in your future, it's in your past. But also the sun turning to darkness, what is so, it's amazing. You know, you read some of this poetry in this old English words, and it says, the sun shall be turned to darkness. Woo! The sun's turned to darkness every night. It happens. What are you talking about? It just happened now. what time does the sun set? 7:30, 8? I mean, yeah. Yeah. And tomorrow at the same time, the sun will turn to darkness. Oh, well. So the sun turned to darkness. Now, it's a picture of a natural day, but it's also a picture of a spiritual day. They're in a new day, man. God birthed the church. It's a new day. It's not a scary thing. It's a beautiful thing. And the nice thing about God is this. God will give you a new day every time you want one. He will cause your sun. Anybody in the room ever just wish for the day to end?
Yeah.
Anybody? Oh, amen. Was today that day?
Yeah.
If not today, I mean, have you had one? I've had quite a few. It's like, I'm looking forward to tomorrow. Yeah, that's nice. Because if you're looking forward to the day to end, he will cause your sun to return to darkness. Great. And it could be an actual day. It could be a season of your life. It could be a time of trouble or that you're going through that you just want to come to an end, a time of sorrow, a time of sickness. He will cause your sun to be turned to darkness. Isn't that beautiful?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, and it goes on. It says, the sun and the moon shall be turned to blood. And once again, you know, the night season, the blood, it's symbolic. The blood is always symbolic of the life of Jesus, man. You know, like in your night seasons, in your hard times, you know, you'll have access to the life of God. You know, it's symbolic before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. When is the day of the Lord? Well, we already talked about it. It was Sunday. It was Resurrection Day and Pentecost Day. So when is the day of the Lord? Anytime you experience Passover. What's Passover? Forgiveness of sins. Anytime you experience forgiveness of sins, you've experienced the day of the Lord. What's Pentecost? Experiencing something spiritual and something supernatural. Anytime you experience something supernatural, you've experienced the day of the Lord. So far, so good, everybody? Yay. Okay, good. Okay. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, you and I know very well that's not in your future. I know very well that's been in your past about a million times. Well, you have called upon the name of the Lord. I don't even think you can count it. You know, Dad, how many times did you just say the name of Jesus, right? Yeah. Like, yeah, right? You ever get caught short? You just say, Jesus. Jesus. Don't stop calling him. Don't stop calling him. I don't stop calling him. That's not in your future. That's well in your past, in your present, and in your future. Anybody who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Aren't you glad you got that name to call upon? Aren't you comforted to know that when you say Jesus, it's like you know he hears you and sees you? Know you have that gift. Anytime you're in turmoil, you can shout out inside yourself or outside of yourself, Jesus, because he will save you, right? It's a promise. It's a promise. Excellent. Great. So let us turn our page. Now, the two elements that we experience on the day of Pentecost, the first element, does anybody know is in your notes there?
Fire.
You know, a lot of times, you know, we're confused. Is fire good or is fire bad? I mean, well, it's bad for the enemies of God and it's good for his friends. You know, who's the enemies of God? It's not people. The enemies of God is old thinking, it's concepts, it's ideas, it's not people. People are never the enemies of God. It's impossible. People are God's favorite thing. You know? People are God's most precious creation. You know, of all the things that God created on earth, he only created people with his hands. And the only thing he had said was very good was people. You see, fire is good. It doesn't destroy, it destroys, but it doesn't destroy people. Destroys ideas, philosophies, old understandings. Has it done that for you at all? No. Okay, well, let's see what the future holds. Okay, moving right along, my silent bunch. It says here in verse 2, I want to reread verse 2 of Acts 2. Somebody shout that out there. And suddenly, shout it out. Go ahead. Brother Mark, I am lost without you. Thank you, brother. And suddenly, there came a sound from heaven. This is what I want to talk about primarily tonight. My question is the same question we've been asking for a few weeks and we've been discovering and rediscovering. Scripture says, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven. The question is, it's in your notes. Where is heaven? Where is heaven? And I know initially we look up, but I think we're discovering that heaven is we'll talk later. Heaven is not a place of up. Heaven is not it's a place of up in a spiritual sense, not in a physical sense, right? Mm-hmm. Heaven is an ascended place. Heaven is a place where you think differently, where you think upon the thing. Scripture says, think upon the things that are above.
That's right.
That's heaven. But we've also come to learn through prior teachings that heaven is also inside you. And that's not too hard to understand. Jesus himself, I love using Jesus for example. Jesus Christ says, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And when he walked the earth, he said very simply, the kingdom of heaven is within you.
That's right. Amen.
Jesus told you where heaven is. It's inside you. Now, whatever may be outside of you, heaven is also outside of you. I'm not going to take that from you. Heaven's outside of you. But heaven's also inside of you. Can anybody dare to give me at least an amen? Like, keep going, something. Five of you. Five, six of you. Okay, good. Okay, so heaven is outside of you, but heaven is also inside of you, everybody. And I think the greatest thing that God is doing in this world is not what he's doing outside of you. It's always what he's doing inside of you. You are more precious than any exterior thing. So when I look at this passage, I've read it many times about the heaven outside of you. I don't know. For a while, let's read about the heaven inside of you. Why don't we just, you know, do that for a little bit. So it says, no one with me? Anybody? Anybody at all? It says, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven. What heaven? The heaven from within you. All of a sudden, there were some words that came out of you. Because where did the tongues come out? It came from out of the people, man. So where did the sound come from? It came from out of the people, man. The sound from heaven came from out of you. That's where the sound from heaven came from. It came from out of them. A new sound came out of people. Anybody ever speak in tongues? A new sound came out of heaven. The heaven inside of you. Where'd the sound come from? Your mouth. Mm-hmm. Your mouth. So heaven must have been inside of you. Somebody here. Somebody
Amen.
In the house.
Amen.
Excellent. So let's talk about the heaven that's inside of you first. And I wanted to, you know, use some passages here just to help us understand that there is certainly a heaven within you. And Pastor Dad, I'm going to ask you to read Jeremiah 20, verses 7 through 9, because I believe it's one of your favorites.
Amen. Lord, you have persuaded me, and I allowed myself to be persuaded. You are stronger than I, and you have overpowered me. Now I am mocked by everyone in the city. Whenever I speak the words that come out in a violent outburst, violence and destruction, I shout. So these messages from the Lord have made me a household joke. And if I can't stop, if I say I will never mention the Lord or speak his name, his word burns in my heart like a fire in my bones. I am weary of holding it in.
You might have quoted that verse once or twice in your lifetime. Yeah. Now, Jeremiah, who lived, I don't know, he lived maybe 600 years prior to Christ, he told you where the fire was. Where was the fire? Inside of him. He says, there's a fire shut up in my bones. What fire was he talking about? The words of God.
That's right. Amen.
So this fire that came on the day of Pentecost, where'd it come from? Heaven. Where was that fire? Inside of them. That fire came from the inside out. That's where the fire came from.
Amen.
And it was stored inside there all along. You see, what I want us to begin to understand is, even in regard to the giving of the Holy Spirit and the day of Pentecost and all the wonderful things of God, I want us to see that there's nothing outside of you getting inside of you. No, 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 no. God created you perfect, man. What God is always doing is getting what's inside of you outside of you.
Amen.
You see, the fire of God, it already dwells in the hearts of man. Of mankind. The fire of God already dwells inside you. What happened on the day of Pentecost was a fire that was shut up inside them came out of them.
Amen.
One way was through their mouth. There was a sound that came from heaven, the heaven that's within you. There is a heaven inside of you, everybody. There is a fire inside you, everybody. I want us to see the fire. It came from heaven, but it came from the heaven inside you. Isn't that something?
Amen.
Man, a fire shut up inside my bones. And that's why even we think, you know, you got to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Yeah, you got to be baptized with the Holy Spirit, that's for sure. But all that means is there must be a release of the heavens that are inside of you. There must be a release. And God will do that in each one of our lives at his own choosing and his own time. Not one person has something different or better than another person. We all have the same exact thing inside of us. We all got the fire of God, the Spirit of God, the power of God. There's not one person that's baptized with the Spirit and one person that isn't necessarily baptized with the Spirit. It's all inside us. What happened on the day of Pentecost, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, something was released from inside of us.
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
And somebody read Leviticus chapter 9, verses 23 to 24. Thank you, Alice. Very good. Do you know the first, like, physical church that was ever erected, if you will, the first temple? You know, was the tabernacle of Moses, the first exterior structure that you can call the house of God, if you will. And the first time that they built this structure, and the first time, you guys with me? And the first time they put a sacrifice upon that altar, the first time when Moses dedicated the tabernacle, it said that, where did the fire come? I know we've talked about this in the past, but let's talk again. Where did the fire come that consumed that offering? Because it wasn't the priest that had the fire. You know, you ever like need a fire? You know, you ever like go to light some candles and somebody needs a light? Anybody got a light? You know, well, you see, they had the sacrifice on the altar and they needed fire to consume this. And the scripture tells us where the fire came from. It said fire came out from the presence of the Lord and consumed the burnt offering. According to scripture and according to the tabernacle, the presence of the Lord, you know, was the Ark of the Covenant. the Ark of the Covenant that was beyond the veil. It said fire came from inside the temple, from the Ark of the Covenant, behind the curtain. A fire came out. We've talked about this. And it burst through the temple. Can you imagine being there that day? same thing, man. You got to know this is not no ordinary house, man. This is definitely the house of God. It might be made with tents and skins, but this is the house of God. It said a fire came out from the presence of the Lord. A fire came from the mercy seat through the tabernacle. It must like whiz by the priests, you know? And blew up the sacrifice that was on the altar. And once that fire came out from the presence of the Lord, came out from inside and it consumed that sacrifice, that fire never, ever went out. The priests were responsible to always keep that fire alive. And every fire that they were ever to use upon that altar was always supposed to come from the original fire, which was from the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
But I want you to see even here, where does the fire come from? There's an inner sanctuary. It comes from the presence of the Lord. I want us to see even here, the fire always dwells inside of you, man. Where's the fire? It's in your innermost being, man. It's in the Holy of Holies. What is the Holy of Holies? It's your heart.
That's right.
It's your heart. That's where the fire comes from. And I want us to see it all throughout Scripture, man. The fire always dwells inside of you, and God just chooses the time when it's going to explode on outside of you.
That's right.
And the beautiful thing about the fire is it goes right through your life. You get put on fire first before anything outside of you.
Right.
Before it comes out of your lips, it goes through your spirit, your soul, and your body.
That's, huh. Right.
That's good. That's good. That's good. It burns you alive. Yeah. Yeah. Beautiful. And also, let's see, somebody who has not read, let's pick it up at John 7, 37 to 38. Just that one King James Version, please.
In the last day, that great day of feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water.
Very good. We'll stop there. I want us to see again, where does the Holy Spirit come from? It comes from inside of you. Otherwise known as heaven, otherwise known as the presence of the Lord. Where does the Holy Spirit live? Inside of you. And anyone who believes, as God causes us to believe and call upon his name, what happens is that the God that's inside of you begins to flow out of you more and more and more. Has anybody in the house experienced a greater outpouring of the God that's inside of you, pouring out of you more and more and more, man? It's the rivers of God that's inside of you that flows outside of you. How does it ever increase? Through your belief in him. As God causes you to believe in him and as your faith to grow in him and to understand him, it causes these waters inside of you to bust outside of you. But I want you to see again, Scripture tells you the source. The source is inside you, out of your bellies. Scripture says, those who believe out of your bellies will flow. This Holy Spirit that came on the day of Pentecost, he came outside from what was inside of them already. The heaven it's talking about was the heaven inside of them. The fire came from heaven. Their hearts, man, came from their hearts out of their mouth, man. That's where it came from. Sure enough, sure enough. So, Heather, I would ask you, would you read that next one? John 7, 38 to 39. Thank you. I wanted to read that additional verse in 39. You see, these rivers of water that God was talking about was the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit that was promised to the church, the same exact Holy Spirit, was going to come. But how was it going to come? From inside of them. That's what Jesus told them. He told them clearly. I think it's clearly. Anybody else? One person want to give me an amen?
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. The Holy Spirit was inside of them. And he says, this Holy Spirit that I promise you is going to come out of you like rivers of living water. Out of your bellies, this Holy Spirit will flow. But we said, oh, I thought it's coming from heaven. God is showing us more and more. There is certainly a heaven outside of you, but there is certainly a heaven inside of you. There is a heaven inside of you. And we all want to access the heaven outside of us because we're far too carnal. We want to access the heaven outside of us because we want all the goodies attached to it. I want the heaven outside of me because there's a mansion there, there's gold there, there's no more tears there. I want that heaven. Give me that heaven.
Amen.
And it's a greater heaven inside of you, man. It's a greater heaven inside of you. That all know nothing on this earth changes, you change, man. There's a peace inside of you. There's a joy inside of you. There's a life inside of you that can still be experienced. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Yeah, amen. Yeah, it's good. Let's see. It goes on about that fire. It talks about the visible sign. I don't know if I want to read all of this, quite honestly. Maybe we'll read down a little bit. Look at the last paragraph on that page. It says, the Spirit, like fire, melts the hearts. It separates and burns up the dross and kindles pious and devout affections in the soul, in which, as in the fire upon the altar, the spiritual sacrifices are offered up. This is that fire which Christ came to send upon the earth. You see, Christ came to send fire upon the earth. There are two elements that happened on the day of Pentecost. The two elements was the fire and the wind. I don't know if we have time to talk about the wind tonight, but the fire was the visible part and the wind was the invisible part. You know, there's a visible part of you and there's an invisible part of you, both of which will show forth the glory of God. Yeah, the deep inside of you, but also the very surface of you will also show forth the glory of God. You know, I even go back and I read Jeremiah again. It says when Jeremiah said in verse 7, he says, oh, Lord, you persuaded me and I allowed myself to be persuaded. Jeremiah says, you are stronger than I am and you overpowered me. Anybody?
Amen.
What did God overpowered Jeremiah to do? He overpowered him to live a life of God. He overpowered him to speak about the things of God. He overpowered him to live a spiritual life. He said, I allowed you to persuade me that there is something in this life that is greater than anything that's natural. I allowed you to persuade me that I am a spiritual being greater than I am a natural being. I allowed you to persuade me of these things. Yeah. And God is stronger than you. He will overcome your thoughts. He will overcome your philosophies. He will even overcome your religion and your theology of who and what you think God is. He will overpower you. And he will cause you to know about the spiritual things, the spiritual life, the spiritual house. Yeah, that's right. And even in these things, Jeremiah goes on in verse 8. He says, whenever I speak, the words come out in a violent outburst. I tell you, some of the violent outbursts that come out is the following. You know, we come against sometimes the natural standards of this world. We come against, you know, our senses, if you will, and rationality, if you will, because we choose to believe that there's something higher to live by. There's a spiritual law to live by. There's a spiritual life to live, you know? And Jeremiah was constantly mocked. He was constantly mocked because he believed in something greater than a physical realm. Constantly mocked. So much so where Jeremiah would say, I'm not going to speak anymore about this life of God. I'm not going to talk about spiritual things. I'm not going to talk about the power and the glory of God. I'm not going to lift up my voice anymore and declare just how great and mighty God is. I'm going to shut my mouth because it gets me in too much trouble. I don't know if you've been there before, but Jeremiah was there once before. He says, I don't need it. I'm just going to live my life natural like everybody else lives their life natural.
Amen.
And I don't know how much time passed by when he goes on and he says, well, I can't do it no more. He says, whenever I speak, the words come out, he says, like a violent outburst. He says, violence and destruction, I shout. So these messages from the Lord, they have made me to be a household joke. But then he goes on in verse 9, he says, but I can't stop. But I can't stop. Yeah. But I cannot stop proclaiming God or his house or the things of God. No, I will not stop. He says they are like a fire shut up within my bones. If I say I will never mention the Lord or speak his name, he says that's not going to happen. There's a fire that burns inside of me, and I am weary of holding it back. I am weary of holding it back. Amen. This is the day of Pentecost. This is the fire of God that's inside of you, that all over everything natural about you tells you to live a natural life, to think naturally, and to take care of all the natural circumstances of life. There is something inside you that says, no, there's a greater life that I'm living, man. Amen. I live for God. You were born for God. The reason why you live and breathe, God shows you to live this supernatural life. And you can try to ignore this supernatural life. You can try to ignore it by living a natural life. Anybody try? Uh-huh. Try. He said, but you're not going to win.
That's right.
You're not going to win. Because God will cause circumstances in your life to cause you to rise up and say, oh, no. He will cause something in your life to have the day of Pentecost fully come upon you, where the fire that showed up inside of your bones is going to come out. And you just might say something like the name of Jesus. Jesus. Jesus.
Amen.
It might cause you to wake up in the morning and pray. Or if you're a praying person, maybe it might cause you to wake up and pray a little louder. It might cause you to say, hey, 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 these naysayers and the enemies of the cross, the ones who don't love God or don't want to serve God, forget you, if you will, these enemies of the cross. Paul had no problem talking about these enemies of the cross. He said, I will serve my God. I will love him and I will proclaim him. And the ones who will be ashamed are the enemies of the cross, not us. We are the spiritual people of God. We will proclaim his goodness. We will proclaim his house. We will proclaim, oh my goodness, all of the wonderful things of God.
Yes, amen.
I believe it's called speaking in tongues, if you will. All of the wonderful things of God. The day of Pentecost is when the heavens are opened and there comes a sound from heaven. Something inside of you breaks outside of you. It's the fire of God. It's the wind of God. Yes, it is. When the day of Pentecost was fully come. Yeah, God opens up the heavens. What is the subtitle of tonight? A release from heaven. Pentecost is a release from heaven. It's a release from inside of you. Let it be. Let something unnatural break out of you. Let it cause a shout inside your mouth, a shout of victory. Let it cause you to proclaim that your God is victorious and strong and mighty and able, right?
Amen.
And therefore you are as well. Let it cause you to proclaim this life that we live, which is far beyond a natural life. It is a godly, spiritual life. And maybe we'll start to thank God, thank God, thank God. We turn the tables, as Jeremiah eventually did, and there's no woe in our mouth. We say, God, thank you for choosing me to proclaim your glory.
Right.
Hold it back. I won't hold it back. It will rage like a flame, like a fire out of my mouth.
Right.
Crying about it, thank you, Lord. You called us. You called us to watch over your house. You called us to glorify your name. You called us to proclaim your kingdom. With all the power of heaven, we will, Lord. With all of the power of heaven.
Amen.
Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Can I get another witness?
Amen.
All right, why don't you all stand? God bless you all. I'm going to ask someone if they'll be so bold to close with a word of prayer, please.